Good evening and welcome to the NAC Experience and Never Alone Christian Center. I'm your pastor, Pastor K. Thank you guys for joining us tonight for Behind the Scriptures, or BTS, our version of Bible study. Let's welcome the Holy Spirit. Father, in the name of Jesus, we welcome your precious Holy Spirit to manifest itself tonight. Teach us, Father. Grow us up, Father. Build us to where you want us to be in the midst of BTS. We give you all the honor, credit, glory, and praise. And it's in Jesus' name we do pray and give thanks. Amen. If you're ready, I'm ready. Let's go.
Every vision and mission requires the financial support of its partners and those invested in the cause. Today, we thank you in advance for your financial support of Never Alone Christian Center.
Once again, welcome to Behind the Scriptures. I'm your pastor, Pastor K. And if you're just joining us, thank you for taking time out of your Wednesday to worship with us in the midst of this particular service. Once again, we thank you for your continued financial support. We bless it. And we thank you for your obedience to our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Keep in mind, you're helping push the vision and the mission forward and helping us build up Never Alone Christian Center. Without further ado, I'm so excited tonight, guys. We're tapping into a brand new series, and I'm ready to get moving with it. So we're going to dive right in tonight, and I'm going to give you our title, or series title, and I'm going to give you our foundational scripture, and we're going to get moving tonight. I'm just ready to do what it is God has called us to do, and you always can tell when it's a new series because I get antsy, because I'm ready to flow, because God has been pouring into me, and I'm so ready to pour into you guys. So our new series that we are embarking upon and launching out today is entitled, How to Avoid Religious Traps. Let me say it one more time. How to avoid religious traps. And our foundational scripture this afternoon or this evening is coming out of the Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. And it reads, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths." Let me read it one more time. It says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths." And other versions say, "He will make straight your path." Father, in the name of Jesus, this is your time, this is your hour, this is your moment. Manifest the gift this evening, God, in the midst of your people. Thank you for another opportunity to glorify your holy and your righteous name by delivering your word to your people that are called and chosen this day. And it's in Jesus Christ's holy name I do pray and allow your spirit to manifest. In Jesus' name, amen. So once again, we're launching into this new series, How to Avoid Religious Traps. And I want to dive right into a few terms and a few definitions. You guys know with a new series, I like to lay down a foundation so that as we flow through the series, you know what our purpose, our objectives, and our goals are. You know what direction I'm trying to take us in the midst of a series. But for the sake of this series, I want to start with some brief definitions, and then we're going to get into our purpose and our objective and our goal. As we said, we're trying to avoid religious traps. And when I say the word trap or traps throughout the course of this particular series, I am referring to any method of teaching our Christian faith that leads to confusion, often based on our opinion and not true doctrine. I want us to understand when I am talking about traps, I am talking about the way that our Christian faith is being taught or has been taught that has led to confusion and is often based upon opinion of man or woman, not true doctrine. When we talk about we want to avoid religious traps, we're saying that many of us have gone into the faith, have started the faith when we were young, or may have just been introduced to the faith, and we've fallen into such traps in the faith, fallen into traps within this religious world, and these things have caused us to either fall away from Jesus, to stop attending our local fellowship, or have caused us not to trust leadership or trust people in the church. And all of these things have derived from traps that were never intended for us to be caught up in. Many of these traps have been set up by the enemy, and a lot of them, in all honesty, have just been based upon the opinion of mankind or whomever may be in operation in your local church. So when I say the word trap, keep in mind that is the term I am referring to. Okay? Now, when I say the word religion or religious, and I want these terms to be at the forefront of your mind, and I will more than likely go over them before each time we begin a new teaching within the series, because I want you to have clarity on exactly what I am referring to. So when I say religion or religious, I am referring to a specific fundamental set of beliefs and practices generally agreed upon by a number of persons or a group of people. This comes directly from a modern day dictionary. A specific fundamental set of beliefs and practices generally agreed upon by a number of persons or people. Ironically, these two terms, religion or religious, are only found in the scripture a handful of times. And you may say, well, how is that possible? This is the Bible. This is the word of God. Why isn't religion or religious found within the scriptures, but only a handful of times? Because Jesus did not teach religion. He taught a way of life. In the Old Testament, they didn't use the term Christianity. They would say, you are of the way. Even in the New Testament with Paul, they would say, are you of the way? In other words, are you of the way of this lifestyle? Are you walking in this way of the Christian faith? Are you walking in the principles of Jesus Christ? Do you believe that he's our Lord and Savior? Do you believe that he was born of the Virgin Mary? Do you believe he was crucified on Calvary's cross and he died for our sins for the remission of mankind? Do you believe he now ascended unto heaven and he's praying for us? So the question becomes, it's not about religion or a set of fundamental practices, but it's about the way of life. So when we talk about how to avoid religious traps, many have fallen in religious traps because they have fallen under the idea or ideology of someone's opinion and or religion. A lot of people have fallen in the way that they have been taught, they have been brought up. And it's sad to bring the news to you, and I hate to be the one. Many of the things that we were taught were not correct. They were not biblically based. They were an opinion. They were a school of thought, but they have no roots to the scripture at all. They sound good. They feel good. They may have worked for our grandma or grandpa or even our parents, but they are not scripturally based. And in actuality, they have become traps for us now that we are adults, and what we were taught was incorrect, and now we're trying to walk in our faith and we are being held down by chains and by bondage because of some way we've been taught that's been incorrect. So we want to avoid these religious traps. Now let's look at a few facts here, some open statements here, as we begin to lay this foundation of our new series, How to Avoid Religious Traps. The 2020 Census of America and Religion has become one of the most colorful pie charts that are available when it comes to stats and religion in America. And I want you to understand, when I talk about the Christian faith and I'm using these particular statistics here, I am talking about America, not globally, okay? So the 2020 census of American religion has become very colorful. This particular pie chart, as I was doing my research, consists of nearly 16 different subsectors of religion. 16 different ways that people are believing. And these are the ones that have been identified. Many people are worshiping and believing and following many gods, many different ways, many different schools of thought. But as you guys know, here at Never Alone Christian Center, our belief and our focus is around Christianity. But when we talk about religious traps, I am not only speaking of Christianity, but many other faiths, many other belief systems also have traps that intertwine us, that bind us, and cause us to be led astray. So this census of religion has multiple religions have been classified in this particular pie chart. But even with all the vast array of paths that man has chosen to take, we are all free to travel whatever path we desire. 7 in 10 Americans, based upon this census of America of religion, 7 out of 10, or 70%, still identify as Christians. Identify as Christians. As you have heard me say many times, do not be persuaded by the speech of those who speak Christianity. Because the word Christianity and the word Christian has been tossed around so much, people attach it to everything. People live in open sin and they attach it to it, and they confuse people, because people think that, oh, well, how can they say they're a Christian and they live this way? Well, first you have to understand, nobody is perfect and everybody doesn't know truth and everybody isn't converted and everybody doesn't walk in their faith. There are many, many Christians who are saved, who are filled with the Spirit of God, but they just don't walk in their faith. Okay? So 70% identify as a Christian. But as I said, do not be persuaded by the speech of those who speak Christianity. But we must be guided by those who live the principles of Christianity. As we say, or have you, as you have heard many times, talk is cheap. Don't focus on what people are calling themselves. Don't focus on the category they are listing themselves, or how they are being classified by Christian or under the Christianity faith or under the religion of Christianity. Don't focus on what they are saying. Focus on how they live. The lifestyle will let you know if they are practicing Christians or they're just verbal Christians. You see, I believe many people have left the church and stopped practicing their faith, not because they stopped loving Jesus, but they have become sick of people and leadership claiming to know Jesus, using faith to trick, trap, and tangle them. Let me say that again. I believe a lot of people have left the church, have stopped practicing their faith, or stopped following the faith of religion because they are sick of people, not Jesus. They're sick of people and leadership who claim to know Jesus, who are using the faith to trick, trap, and tangle them. All of these tricks, traps, and tangles that we are blaming on the devil are being fabricated not by the devil, but by people in position in the church who are confused themselves, and they're pushing that false doctrine and agenda on us who are trying to live free in our faith. You see, and the purpose of this teaching is I want to help us avoid some common religious traps often found in the Christian church. Okay? It's not my responsibility to handle what the Muslims are doing or what the Catholics are doing. That's not my responsibility. My responsibility in this purpose of this teaching is I want to help us avoid some common religious traps often found in the Christian church, and to go a step further, if you have been trapped or entangled or you've been tricked, hopefully through the course of this teaching, I will be able to, with the Spirit of God, to help you get out of these traps, to break what you have been taught if it's incorrect, to help you see stuff from God's perspective, not necessarily the perspective that you have been raised upon that may have been wrong. Some of the things that we have been taught, there's 90% of it true and 10% of it is false. So if 10% of it is false and 90% is true, it's not truth at all. It's either all the way true or it's untrue. There is no middle ground there. There's no lukewarm truth. It's either the truth or it's not. You see, our faith that we so dearly love and cherish with our lives must be protected at all cost. It is the responsibility not only of myself, but other religious leaders, people who are teaching Christianity, and other Christians. It's our responsibility to protect the gospel of Jesus Christ, to protect the faith at all costs. Therefore, we must help people avoid religious traps so that they can live free in Christ Jesus. There is no perfect church. There is no perfect pastor, and there are no perfect leadership, okay? So get that out of your mind. People in position, called, chosen, anointed, filled with the Spirit of God, tongue-talking, make mistakes. Is that an excuse? No, but it is a reality. Therefore, we have to understand, we have to put our trust, as we said in our foundational scripture, in the Lord. And as we put our trust in the Lord, we follow those who are serving God with all their might and ability. Okay? But we serve a perfect God, and His name is Jesus. He has given us a roadmap, and we're going to get down into these objectives here. He's given us a roadmap on how to carry the gospel throughout the world. He has left us the Holy Spirit as our helper. So I ask the question, how and when did the Christian church take so many wrong turns? Where did we get twisted, entangled, and tricked to the point where those who love Jesus have no desire to fellowship with the body of Christ? What did the church do? What has the Christian faith become with those who are saved still don't want anything to do? Those who have tried to walk with Jesus are turned off by the people who are in position, or by the congregation, or by the attitude, or by the charismatic pushing of faith on people, and they don't have a desire to suffer. Where did the church take this term? Where did all these traps and tricks and tangles start? Why are they in the church? Why are they in the church? The church shouldn't be the place. The faith shouldn't be the place where people are being tricked, tangled, and trapped. It's not the place for it. So we have to move ourselves into a position, and we have to understand that God did not design the church. And when I say the church, I'm referring to the people of God, not the physical building, but the fellowship of people. He did not design us to fellowship with one another with trickery. All right. So throughout the course of this teaching, we have seven objectives, and we're going to take our time and work through these objectives, because I believe it's critical for us to understand that God does not want us to be trapped by faith. He doesn't want us to be trapped by religion. He doesn't want us to be confused. Many people I speak to love Jesus, but they are so confused with so many things in the body of Christ because they simply have not been taught properly or haven't been taught at all, or possibly they don't know how to find the answer they're trying to search for, and they are trying to do what God wants them to do, but they are perplexed. And God specifically tells us not to be perplexed. Okay? So the first objective we are going to tackle, and we'll begin with that first objective, is we need to know, number one, the purpose of the Christian church. That's our first objective. Before we can get into the traps and the tricks and be entangled, we need to know what is the purpose of the Christian church. What did God establish in the book of Acts? What did he establish with the 12? What was he trying to implement in the New Testament? What is it that Jesus was trying to get us to do? And how have we gone from what he was trying to get us to do 2,000 years ago to where we are now in 2021? How did we go from that unto this? Now, don't get me wrong. There are many, many, many churches doing what God has assigned them to do. But unfortunately, there are just as many not doing the assignment. Number two, the second objective is we want to look at the biblical format of the Christian church. First, we want to look at the purpose, and then we want to look at the biblical format of the Christian church. Now, this format is subject to change based upon the assignment or the calling of the pastor or leader or overseer, bishop, whatever you are calling them. Okay, based upon the vision that God has given them, that format may look different in each church, but the format or the basic blueprint should always lead back to Jesus and him crucified, to Jesus and saving God's people, to Jesus and the Holy Spirit, to Jesus and the gifts of God's people. No matter how the vision may be structured based upon that overseer, no matter how their purpose may be aligned, there always should be a fundamental belief system and or principles that lead back to biblical foundations of Jesus Christ. And then objectives 3-7 are going to be some traps. Obviously, there are many traps that can be found in the Christian church, but some that we're going to look at. Number three, objective number three, trap number one we're going to look at is good money versus bad money. Money is always a factor in the Christian church. And unfortunately, there have been many, many ways it has been taught, but it's so simplistic in the scripture. I don't understand how we have gotten the money train so confused. The scripture speaks on it very, very clear. And it's a small portion of the entire Bible, yet it has led many astray. Trap one, good money versus bad money. Objective number four, trap two, opinion versus sound doctrine. Many of us have been taught with the opinion of man and not sound doctrine. Trap number three, which will be our objective number five, spiritual principles versus natural principles. Spiritual principles versus natural principles. Many Christians have been trapped in the principles of spirituality, trying to apply them to the natural world, and it doesn't compute because what's taking place in the spiritual principles don't always compute with what is natural, because God and God is spiritual and we live in a natural realm. They don't always compute, but we've been trapped in the middle because we haven't been taught properly. haven't been taught properly. Trap number four, which is our objective number six, the Holy Spirit versus not having the Holy Spirit. This should not be a trap, but it is. Many Christians feel like they are trapped because they believe in the Holy Spirit, but their church doesn't. Or their church doesn't, and they do. And now they're stuck in the middle of their faith, and this should not be. Jesus once again speaks very clear on the Holy Spirit. But it has become a trap. And the last objective, number seven, which will be trap number five. Old school counseling versus new school counseling. And when I say old school versus new school, it's not to be critical, it's just terminology. Old school counseling versus new school counseling, trap number five. Many leaders are being caught in this trap number five. Many Christians are being caught in this trap number five because they're doing old school counseling versus new school counseling. The principles are the same, the scriptures are the same, but the format in which we do it has to change. And the goal of this teaching is to walk in our faith with freedom. That's it. We want to walk in our faith in freedom. Our faith, which is Christianity, serving Jesus Christ, being of the way, was never designed to be bondage. Why are so many Christians trapped in their faith? Let's pray. Well, Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you, first of all, for your precious Holy Spirit. And tonight, God, we are excited about our new series, How to Avoid Religious Traps. So tonight, I just want to extend a brief opening to those who may be unsaved. This is our Behind the Scriptures Midweek Teaching, BTS, as we like to call it, our version of Bible study. But I never assume everyone knows Jesus Christ. You say, well, Pastor K, I'm ready to accept Jesus Christ. I've been trapped so long in this faith, and I'm ready to get out this trap. And I want to welcome you to the body of Christ. Simply stretch forth your hands wherever you may be, unless you are driving or in a situation where you need your hands. Repeat this prayer after me. Whether you're unsaved, saved in a backslidden state, or you just want to help extend your faith and touch and agree with us, I want you to repeat the prayer. It says, Father, in the name of Jesus, forgive me for my sins. Wash me and cleanse me from the crown of my head to the soles of my feet. Today, God, I acknowledge I am a sinner and I am in need of a Savior. And today I welcome you, Jesus Christ, as my Savior. I believe that you were born of the Virgin Mary, that you lived in the earth, that you were crucified on Calvary's cross, that you died just for me and the remission and the washing of my sins. I believe that you served my sentence in hell, and I believe that you were raised on the third day by your Father, and now you have all power in heaven and in earth. And right now I ask that you send me the Holy Spirit that I might have power to overcome the enemy, to avoid these religious traps. Thank you for my salvation. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. If you have repeated that prayer, first of all, welcome to the body of Christ. I want you to go one step further and visit our website at neveralonecc.org. There you can click on the link that says Start Your Journey, the little icon there, or click on the link in our bio on all our social media platforms. There you will find more information on your new faith journey. And if you have questions and or concerns, reach out to us with our information email and we will help you on your way. Father, in the name of Jesus, bless your people called and chosen by your name. Protect them from all hurt, harm, danger, seen and unseen. Thank you right now in the name of Jesus for their protection and their salvation. And it's in Jesus' name we do pray and give thanks. I love you. Amen. Let's go.